CYC is a free channel that presents the Word of God for everyone. Your support will help us to continue the mission. Visit our website, cycnow.com. Even a dollar will make a difference.
تكريسا مقدسا لبيت الله امين
امين.
نكرس هذا الموضع كنيسه جامعه على اسم السيده العذراء ورئيس الملائكه جليل ميخائيل كنفران ايميفيوت ميمبشيري نمبر نفما اسطوات ونوتي الموؤوت افزمار الاوت الجي افنوتي فيوت في بانتوكراتون كنيسة جامعة باسم السيدة العذراء ورئيس ملائكة جليل ميخائيل فزما رأوتن جيبث منو جنيسن شيري إيسوس بإخريسطوس بان شويس
آمين.
نكرس هذا الموضع كنيسة جامعة باسم السيدة العذراء ورئيس الملائكة جليل ميخائيل فزما رأوتن جيبث منو جنيسن شيري إيسوس بإخريسطوس بان شويس آمين.
Yeah. Interceding on behalf of angelic armies in the heavenly order, the Hina gave us our sins. Ask him for you are born our world, we say you to take away our sins, and accord to us his peace. We ask you to remember us, our gifts, our gifts before the Lord Jesus Christ, and he may forgive us our sins. We exalt your merit and love
you. The highest saint of the
gospel, Lord, hey, behold, Lord, you came and saved our souls. Glory to our master, our King, Christ, the Father, the Apostles, the Prime, the Martyrs, the Joy, the Righteous, the Furnace of the Church, and forgive us of sins. We proclaim one Holy Trinity, one Godhead. We worship him, we glorify him. Lord, have mercy, Lord, bless us, amen.
We believe in one God, God the Father, the Father, the Lord, created in heaven and earth, and all things seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ.
Oh, Joseph, may the Lord keep your life.
Because
On this day, we celebrate the consecration of the Church of Resurrection in Jerusalem. That's why whenever we consecrate a church, we replace the reading of the day with the reading of the 16th of Tut. Why? As you heard in this dialogue between the Lord and Saint Peter, the Lord said to Peter, "You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven." So we chose this gospel because this gospel actually matches the celebration of the day, which is the consecration of the new church. Before I speak about the church, I like to tell you the true church is you. Buildings, you know, regardless how beautiful they are, after some years, they will be demolished and new buildings will be built. So the true church is you, because we never be demolished. We are the temple of God, and the Holy Spirit abides in you. Many times, we pay a lot of attention, a lot of effort, a lot of money, and we invest just to have beautiful churches. And this is very good. This is actually something blessed. But do we invest in us and in our children as human beings or not? Many times we don't want to invest in developing ourselves or developing our children or developing our congregation. We don't invest either financially or effort or any kind of investment. Although the investment in human being will last, but the investment in buildings will not last. So the true church is us, and if we did all this effort to make our church beautiful like this, let us ask ourselves how much effort we did in order to make the temple of God, which is us, beautiful to him. I just attended a funeral yesterday, and the wife said about her husband who departed that the last words that he said before his departure, "I kept the temple of God holy." And actually, who can say this before the time of his departure? "I have kept the temple of God holy. I did not defile the temple of God," which is me, which is us. Who can keep the temple of God holy and defile it? This is actually very important. Church comes in the scripture with three meanings. The first meaning is us, as I told you, we are the temple of God, and the Holy Spirit abides in you. Second meaning is the building, church as a building. And third meaning, church as priesthood. You remember in Matthew chapter 18, when the Lord said, "If your brother sins against you, go and discuss it with him alone. If he did not listen to you, take with you two others, so every word will be witnessed by two or three witnesses. If he didn't listen to them, go and say to the church." What does it mean here by the church? It means here to the priests, to the clergy. And after this, he gives them the authority when he said, "And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you lose in earth will be lost in heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound." So church has three meanings in the scripture: either priesthood, or us, the temple of God, or heaven. Today I'd like to speak about the church as building, because we are celebrating the consecration of this beautiful church. The first point I like to think about that David, a man after God's heart, as the Bible says, David is a man after the heart of God. David, God said to him, you cannot build a temple for me because your hand is defiled with blood. And he told him, you will not build the temple, but your son will build the temple instead of you. So every time actually we build a church, I think about this, about how honored we are, because we receive privilege that David himself, the ancestor of Christ, did not get. David is a grandfather of the Lord Jesus Christ. So David himself did not get this privilege to build the temple of God. But God allowed us, we, the sinners, the humble, the weak, to participate in building his church. So do we deserve this? Of course not. It is the grace of God. It is the grace of God which allowed us to have this privilege and this honor to build his church. That's why today we should actually lift our hearts in thanksgiving and praise to the Lord who allowed us to participate in building his church. Second point, when God said to David, you cannot build my church, but your son will build it. David did not get angry with God, did not become upset with God. But actually, if you listen carefully to the readings that we read during the vision, one of the readings was about David and how he was happy because he prepared from his own money, from his own position, from his own personal position. He prepared to the Lord whatever the temple needed. He prepared the gold, the silver, the copper, all the materials, everything, the wood, everything, everything. So actually Solomon, when he built the temple, did not need to buy anything, because all the materials were available. And this actually tells us a lot about David. Indeed, he is not after the heart of God. Maybe if any one of us was in the place of David and God told us, you will not build the church, so we say, okay, I'm not going to build the church, I'm not going to contribute, I'm not going to do anything for this church. Sometimes when a person does not join the world, so we start to quit coming to the church, start supporting the church, just because he didn't choose him in the world. What about if God told you clearly, as David, you are not worthy to build my church? What would be our reaction? But David actually told us a very important lesson. That he said, at least if I will not be blessed by building the church, the temple of God, at least I will prepare all the material from his own personal mind. And he prepared everything, everything. Actually, the amount, when I heard the vision, it's huge amount of silver and gold and precious stones and. But he did this gladly because he loved the church very, very much. He used to say, I was glad when he told me, let us go to the house of God. So this is a second point we learn here today from David, that if we did not participate, at least we can contribute, can support, contribute not only financially, but with any method of contribution that we can actually participate in serving the Lord and being blessed by serving in the house of God. The third point, actually, the idea of the church
is the idea of God Himself. It is God actually who instructed us to have a place for Him. And Solomon was wondering why God is asking to have a place. He said, the heaven is your throne and the earth is your footstool. So, which building we will build for you? Heaven and earth actually cannot contain you. So, can we contain God in this small place? Definitely not. But why God actually asked us to make a place for Him? This is not for Him, but this is for us. What do I mean? Not for Him, but for us. You remember Adam and Eve were living in the paradise. Then actually, after the fall, God cast them out of the paradise. He came to them outside the paradise, to the earth. So the earth became defiled. There is corruption in the earth. There is defilement. There is curse. The Lord cursed the earth. That's why a lot of suffering around us, because we are living in a corrupted world. We are living in a cursed land, cursed earth. So God, out of His love, He wanted to remind us with the paradise of joy. So He told us, take a place and separate this place from the rest of the world. And make this place my place. And I will come and I will dwell in this place. And I will give it a special blessing. If anybody comes to this place and pray, I will accept his prayer. If anybody sinned and came to this place and repented, I will forgive his sin. If anybody did anything wrong and came to this, I will correct him. So God actually, out of his love, he told us, I want to give you heaven on earth. So choose a place and separate this place from the rest of the world, and I will come and I will make it my dwelling place. And I will give this place a special blessing, and I will make it different than the rest of the earth. Not only that, but having a place among us, this means God is with us. Emmanuel, God is with us. So God is dwelling among us. As each one of us has house, so God has also house among us. What a blessing that we have in our life, that God is dwelling among us. That's why in the third hour of the prayer we say, when you stand in your holy sanctuary, you are standing in heaven. Indeed, you are standing in heaven. Because actually, in the Orthodox theology, we call the church the icon of heaven. The church is the icon of heaven. Because in heaven, actually, we see Christ sitting on his throne as lamb. As lamb slaughtered, as you read in Revelation chapter 5. And in the church, you see Christ slaughtered on his throne, and his blood is shed for us. In heaven, we will be surrounded by the angels and by the saints. And these icons, not just mere piece of wood, no. By consecrating these icons, actually, the saints come and be with us. And actually, every saint blesses his icon. So there is a special blessing in the icons after we consecrate them. And this is not idol worship. Because maybe some people will tell you, this is like the worshiping of idols. No, it is not. Because God actually honors his people and honors his saints in so many ways. In the Old Testament, when he buried the body of Elisha, a And after that he buried him, a dead man fell on the tomb of Elisha. Just because he fell on the tomb of Elisha, he rose from the dead. And this actually tells us about the blessing that God gave to the saints, to the relics, to the bones, because they were the temple of God. And God actually, in the Old Testament, in the tabernacle of meeting, he asked Moses to do the angels, the cherubim and seraphim, on the veil. So there were icons there. And God actually, through the material, the substance, blessed us. Because God became man to bless the substance. And we can be blessed through the substance. That's why actually all the sacraments are given to us through substance. For example, the baptism given to us through water. The Holy Spirit in Christmission given to us through oil. His body is given to us through bread and wine. In the same way, God actually and the Holy Spirit blessed his icons, and every saint blesses his own icon, and there is a special blessing when actually we venerate the icon. So when we enter the church, actually we are considered in heaven, we are surrounded by the saints, by the cloud of witnesses around us, and also we have Christ on the altar. And there is a special blessing for the Church of God. Otherwise, tell me, why the Lord Jesus Christ was very, very upset when the people converted the place of worship into a market? We never saw the Lord Jesus Christ angry like this, but this is a holy anger, what we call indignation, zeal, holy zeal. We never saw the Lord Jesus Christ like this, but the disciples understood and said, the zeal of your house has eaten me up. The zeal of your house has eaten me up. For this is the house of God. This is the house of God. Jacob, when God appeared to him in Bethel, he said, this is the house of God and this is the gate of heaven. This is the house of God and this is the gate of heaven. Indeed, God is in this place. And I did not know. حَقَّ الْأَمْرَ رَبِّ فِي هَذَا الْمَكَانَ وَمَا الْأَعْلَى. Indeed, God is in this place, and I did not know. So there's a special blessing here. And God called this house a house of prayer. That's why he rebuked the people when they converted the house of prayer and made it a house of merchandise. And he told them, don't make my father's house a house of merchandise. Because this house is separated from the rest of the world to be house of prayer, house of God, house of the angels. And by the way, the word to consecrate, actually in its original language, means to separate, to separate. So when I say I consecrate, means I separate. Separate this place from the rest of the world to dedicate it to Christ. That's consecration. I separate these vessels from the rest of the world to consecrate it, to dedicate it for Christ. That's consecration. So, we need actually to keep and to respect the house of God. David said, as for me, in the multitude of your mercies, I enter into your house and worship before your holy altar in fear. Actually, when we enter the church, we should know that we enter the church in the multitudes of the mercies of God. None of us, and I'm the first among you, don't deserve to be here. But it is the multitude of the mercies of God who made us worthy, as we say, in the divine liturgy, who made us worthy to stand up in this holy place and lift up our hands. So we should remember every time we enter the church that we are entering in the multitudes of the mercies of God. David knew that the angels, this is the house of angels, if this house of God is the angels in this house. That's why he said, before the angels, I enter your house and worship before your holy altar. Before the angels, I enter your house and worship before your holy altar. David loved the house of God. He said, how lovely are the courts of the Lord. My soul desire and long to enter into the house of the Lord. One day in your courts are better than 1,000 outside your courts. I choose to sit at the door of the house of the Lord better than dwelling in the courts of the sinners. And another psalm he said, God, who can abide in your house? And who can ascend in your holy mountain? Only those who have pure heart and have good works. So, we should know coming to the church is different than coming to any other place. This is the house of God. This is the house of prayer. We should actually venerate and respect this church because God and the angels and the saints are dwelling here. This is the house of God. And David actually was very, very happy to go to the church. As I told you, one of the psalms said, I was glad when they told me, let's go to the house of the Lord. But why he was happy? Because actually, every time he entered into the house of God, regardless how sad he was, regardless how upset he was, regardless how grieved he was, how burdened he was, how stressed he was, how anxious he was. Every time he entered, he had peace. That's why he said, I will enter into the house of God before the face of God who gladdens my heart, who brings joy to my heart. So entering into the house of God will bring joy to our heart. And all of us will know the story of Hannah, the mother of Samuel. Before she had Samuel, she was barren. And actually, she was very, very upset and disappointed. Nobody was able to comfort her, even her husband. So at the end, she resolved to go to the church and to pray. And only praying in the church actually took this sadness from her heart. And she was comforted and she was at peace because she entered into the house of God. When we enter into the house of God, regardless how burdened we are, but the Lord who promised us to take away our burden and to give us peace and rest, he will give each one of us joy, peace, and rest in our hearts. So it is a big blessing to have a church and to have this church consecrated. Let's praise God and thank him for this honor and for this blessing. And let us promise God that we will respect this church as a house of prayer, only house of prayer, house of worship, house of blessing. And let's ask God, as he comforted Hannah, mother of Samuel, as he brought joy to the heart of David, let's ask God to make this place a place of joy for all of us. Every time we come, we rejoice and we'll be glad and we'll become happy because we are standing before the face of God who brings joy to our hearts